Good evening and welcome to Sunday Interview. Now, my guest this evening is no stranger to the political arena. She has served in several capacities in several portfolios in government. She became leader of her political party in 2005 and has contested the presidential election twice in 2011 and 2015, coming out seventh and third, respectively. She is known as tenacious and outspoken. She's a family woman, a mother, and an entrepreneur. My guest this evening, Edith Nawakwi, the president for the Forum for Democracy and Development. Welcome to the program.
Good evening, Mr. Zulu. Hope you're well.
I'm fine, thanks. I'll start by asking you to take us through your life. Edith Nawakwi is somebody many people would not know beyond politics. If you were to describe yourself, who is Edith Nawakwi?
Well, a lot of people know me beyond politics. They know that I'm a mother, a grandmother now, and that I'm a marketeer. Many people who struggle to survive in this country do know who Edith Nawakwi is as their friend and a person who will be there for them. I'm a farmer. That's how my peers who know me best would recall who I am. And my peers are usually found in most of the markets, whether it is the border town of Kasumbalesa, they've sold our bananas from the farm. So I'm basically a simple village girl, privileged enough to get an education and be found in a position that I'm found. And this I consider a position of privilege because many of my colleagues were born together. They never got an opportunity to get an education. So I am someone who is known as a Zambian politician, a farmer, and a mother. Basically, that's Edith Nawakwi.
I want you to take us back to your childhood. Growing up as a young girl, is leadership something that really struck you as something you would really pursue up to a level of being a politician, wanting to be president?
Growing up when you are young, yes, you have ambitions. But it's the steps that your parents take you through that get you where you are. I think basically you mold a child between the age of 0 years and 5 years. And most people who study the growth and development of children will tell you a child is conceived and that's the moment you begin to mold that child. How the mother carries herself, how the family interacts has a lot to do with the future of a child. I think if you look at the history of most musicians, their parents could have been musicians, they would be singing. And that starts very early. I think our children begin to listen to us when they are not yet born, when they are in the womb. I grew up in the village amongst parents who were subsistence farmers. My father is still alive, my mother passed on. May her soul rest in peace. But we grew up working on the land as subsistence farmers. And that has a lot to do with what I do right now and how I understand that life should change. Because I grew up tilling the land using a hoe. From time to time, obviously, my mother would say, wake up, let's go. It would be like 4 a.m. because we had to walk long distances to go to our fields. So I'd walk an equal distance to go to the field or walk an equal distance to go to school. And I chose that school was much easier to do than work on the land. But that's what molds you. I was born in between two boys, and being born in a patrilineal society, which we still face today, I think you recall that in our traditional setup, girls are considered of not being the owners of the family estate, meaning that when you are born, your parents think that the only value for girls is what I see now in the rural areas when I travel to Chama, go to Mugoti, I go to these places. I see that our parents are still not putting so much emphasis on the girls' education. But I was privileged enough that my parents took education as a priority. They would do anything to get me to school. And that's why the alternative to staying at home was to, if you're not going to school, get your hoe, let's go to the field. Well, at school, at least you play. Going to school was easier, obviously. I had more freedoms in the class, and I would walk back. Working in the field using a hoe is not the easiest of things for a child. Now it's called child labor, but then, and I still think that it still should be considered as part of child education, how we bring up our children, whether to fetch water, firewood, go in the field, cook. I noticed that the children who are brought up in the villages now, when they come to my house, they actually cook better than the children who are brought in town, because they know at an early age that they have to look after themselves. If you are left in the village alone, you have to cook for yourself. So in the village, the children tend to learn faster than when they are in urban areas, yeah, because there's a maid, there's a chef, everything is provided for them. And we are not really putting much emphasis on early childhood education. It's not just about books, it's about survival skills that we must impart to our children at a very, very early age.
Mm-hmm. Now, people would want to know, you talked about being born in between two brothers. You were only three in the family?
No, we are more than that, but a number of my siblings have passed on. I'm saying I was born in between two brothers, meaning I had to struggle between the boys to be heard, because by nature of being a girl in between two boys, they take precedence in the family.
Are you the only woman in the family?
No, I have got three sisters, and I've got now surviving three brothers. Two have passed on.
You spoke passionately about education. I want you to tell us about your educational background. How easy was it to go through school at the time when gender equality was probably not even heard of?
Well, I started grade one at the age of nine. I think they used to say that when you are 6 years old, you can go to school, but it was dependent on how you put your hand on your head and touch the other ear, then you are either six. By virtue of that, I don't know what would happen if you have long hands. And for three times in a row, I couldn't put my hand to touch my ear, and I was left out. So the last time they came to the 20th girl, and I was left out. Didn't I weep? I yelled, I screamed, I fell on the ground. Why? I said, but which means I would have started school when I was 10. So it wasn't easy, because there was only Mwenzo Primary School then, and there was a lot of kids around that school. So they were choosing the older girls to get into class. Luckily, I got to start grade one, and I've never looked back. I went from grade one to grade 12 at Kasama Girls. I passed to go to Kasama Girls, and ended up at the University of Zambia, one of the very lucky few girls from the village. From our school, there were 12 of us who moved from Mwenzo Girls to Kasama Girls. And I'm happy to say, from Kasama Girls to university, we managed, all of us who went to university, to graduate. One of my sisters who graduated is now a professor in the UK, Juliana Singogo. And we have one of them, Mrs. Rosemary, she's a director at one of the universities. I've had a lot of teachers. And really, I think it was a good team that we had. And that shows you that if you choose your friends carefully when you're young, you are bound to succeed. And most of the vices that we have, if you talk about who is your friend about the kids, you find that if the kids are in wrong company, that tends to impact on their future, because they could go into drugs, they could go into other vices. I'm glad that we all finished.
You graduated with a Bachelor of
Bachelor of Arts in Economics and Business Studies, and I went to the University of Surrey. I did postgraduate in Energy Economics, and then in Development Economics, and then I went to University of London, Imperial College, and had my MSc there. I came back to Zambia towards 1989-90. I couldn't work because, look, at the time my salary in the civil service was 200 kwacha. And I had responsibilities to look after a lot of people from my village, because I began to see the value of education. I wanted to pull my siblings up, or if there's a child who is bright enough, I invest a lot of the little I have in education. It's not just for my immediate family, for a lot of people who come my way and say, I'm struggling with school fees. If I have, I'll do everything to support a bright kid. And I do not believe that there's any of our children who is down. I actually think that all children have potential, and no child should be judged by the circumstances of their parents. A good example is myself. If the circumstances of my parents had to be in the way of education, I wouldn't be sitting here. But I was given an opportunity. There was free education at the time, and the scholarships to university and scholarships to go and do my MSc, which one can only say it's a privilege that you'd want every child to have.
Before we get into politics, I want to ask you, what are your interests socially? And do you even have time now that you're a very active politician to for any other issues besides politics?
Well, I mean, when you talk about time is divided in the interest that you want to save your life. I mean, you have to have time to go to church, you have to have time to meet family, time to interact in the community, and time basically to repose. I mean, it's important that you find time to sit down and do the interests you have. I have a treadmill in the house, and when I have a moment, I get on the treadmill. And sometimes when it's not too dangerous to venture outside, I go for a walk. We do walk for close to 6 kilometers in the morning. And in a very casual way, you find that in 45 minutes, you can do 5 kilometers, which is good for health.
Now, what best describes you? Leonard, intelligent, tough-spoken, fearless?
No, I am just one of the very few Zambians who has had a privilege to get an education, be exposed, and be experienced. I think to describe my situation is that of one who has enough experience acquired from listening to people, interacting, and being educated in the village setting. When I get to a village, I do get time to sit down. I'm not one of those politicians who finishes a meeting and rushes away from the scene. I think those who have been on my delegation will attest to the fact that when we finish a meeting, I want to have more time with people. And the best time to have with people is when you are sharing a meal. And you find that in most villages, people just wonder. I walk to a homestead and say, what have you cooked here? I once arrived at Chief Mbangombe's palace, and I could see they had just finished eating. And I went to the kitchen, and I was very hungry, actually.
You prepared
I found Shima, but I wasn't offered because I said, no, we didn't think you would eat. But why wouldn't I eat? This is my village. I'm from the village. What's the difference? Some people, you see them carrying big cool boxes of food and whatever they need. But, I mean, when you want to learn from people, interact with them, and what more than in the traditional way where as Chinua Achebe says, that when in the African setting, there's a big shima, and you meet at the center when you are eating from the same plate and say, are you also here? And that interaction where you share a meal with families in the rural areas provides a very unique opportunity for learning. You get to know how people are surviving. You can't get that on a public forum where you are just basically addressing the people. You get to know how many children in that village are going to school. What are their challenges? Are they getting water? Are their animals getting enough water? Are they dipping their animals? And you see, through those interactions that we had even an opportunity to find out in Southern Province that some old ladies have to walk for 30 kilometers to dip their animals. And, well, I mean, in my position, we do get across some resources from contributors, and we have been able to provide a dip tank in Chief Muchila, and the ladies there are very happy. But you can't learn that at a public meeting. You have to learn to sleep in the villages, interact, eat with them, and fully aware that our people in the villages, they have more experience about life than we have in urban areas.
Let's move to your political life. I want to trace back your political activism to 1990, when Zambia's economy was almost on its knees. I guess that's a time you got on the movement for multi-party democracy, MMD. Was that your beginning of active participation in politics?
No, it wasn't the beginning. I think that if you trace my life back to secondary school, primary school, I was always given a role to lead. And that's what I refer to as training. I think at primary school and secondary school, I had responsibilities at Kasame Girls as a deputy head girl and a leader in the Scripture Union and do all sorts of activities. I found myself heading the Red Cross team at school and being in charge of responsibilities, small as they were. Father John Borie gave me the responsibility every Friday to screen films to the girls and collect little tokens of contributions from the girls to, so that we could order the next films. It starts at that level. So leadership is not something you can just wake up and say, I'm a leader. It is requires training. And as I've always said at other forums, some people will say they are managers, but there's basically a difference between a manager. A manager manages something for someone. A leader provides vision and direction. And going through the mill and going to university and starting to work and doing research, you begin to see that there is a difference in the way people should live. 1990 just came at a time when our country needed voices of leadership, and I happen to be one of those voices. I don't accredit anything that happened in 1990 to one person. It was a collective, the trade unions, the civil society, and those of us who were in a small group called the Zambia Research Foundation, composed of the Mbitachitalas, Agashamba Twembi Kustalewanika, and a few other colleagues. We led the team that became the voice later on of MMD. And yes, it is a spark at that point because you can identify it. But if I was shy to stay away from groups of people who are discussing, I would never have found myself in these groupings.
Mm-hmm. I was What really drives you? What motivated you to get into politics? To think you
the
could,
desire you could get to think that our country can have a difference. I think if you look at 1990, the theme was that we all acknowledge that dictatorship, one-party state, and its offshoots had brought us to our knees as a country. And our analysis at that time was that we were sliding into abject poverty, which we are still going into this point in time, because the people of Zambia did not have a voice. You cannot have democracy without, you cannot have development without a democracy. It is only when you free people's minds, they begin to have creative potential released. They begin to think for themselves. You begin to think that if I'm in a house, I need to go out to Soweto Market and order some vegetables and sell. But if you are scared to even venture out of your home, then you cannot develop. You look at children in a home. When they are scared, when a parent comes home and all the children keep quiet because daddy or mommy has come home, in that homestead, you never know what the children will do that will shock you, because you've suffocated their ability to open up. And that also translates to a nation. When a nation is bottled up, it's like a pressure cooker. At some point, if you force it to open, you can even kill people. It's like a volcano in Iceland when it erupted. It had been quiet but bubbling underneath. And eventually, when the Iceland volcano erupted, I think you recall that the entire Northern Europe and Americas were engulfed volcanic ash, and the economy is grounded. It's the same with the human beings. It's the same with a nation. You need your people to be free to express themselves. You can only know what Edith Nawakwi is thinking if you bring me on ZNBC and the people hear me. Otherwise, you won't know. If I'm quiet, you call me, come to the radio station, and I don't come here, you don't know what I'm thinking. I think the art of leadership in any nation is that people must be free to express themselves. And we spearheaded that movement for free speech for freeing ourselves from the yoke of poverty and dependence on the state to a position where we said to people, you can be better off, use what you have and move. And I think we achieved that. And I'm glad that I was part of that. I think history, when it's written, I'm sure my little name will be somewhere in a footnote.
In the middle.
In the footnote.
Not that, right at the top.
No, I think a footnote will be sufficient. After all, when you pick up a book, you first go to the footnotes.
Now, I want to look at your experience and your capacities. You've been Deputy Minister of Energy, First Female Finance Minister, Minister of Labour, Minister of Energy, and Minister of Agriculture. You have really worked and served in government. Has this really helped you and motivated you further to think now you can lead the country?
Save, I've never received any insignia. I'm sure they'll give me when I'm dead. You know, I see everybody receiving these nice bands of honour, and no one has ever recognised that little Edith Nawakwi can also be honored, but I'm grateful to my ladies in the women's movement who recognize me that I've saved, and I'm truly grateful for that honor. I did get that experience, which I view as a privilege. And at the moment, of all the politicians on the political landscape now in Zambia, especially on the ballot paper, I possess the experience that none of them possesses. Whether it is politically or administratively, or in fact the experience of life, of going in the rural areas. As Minister of Energy, I got to understand the needs of our people in peri-urban Zambia. Every now and then there's cholera. Then Minister of Health goes out and say, boil your water. I can assure you, Mr. Zulu, that if you go to Kwalinda and you tell a parent to boil water, they don't have enough charcoal to boil that water. That's what I got to understand, that, you know, development is a system. You cannot tell a child to wait for an education because you are building a road, or a mother to wait for 5 years because you are building a hospital. That mother should wait to boil the water because cholera comes in December. And why is it coming? It's because our people have contaminated water. You only do that if you can go into George Compound and observe the way our people are living. And that's across the board. And Mr. Zulu, it should never be like that. It shouldn't be like that. I think that we should all know that water is a right. But my going out to Chilenje Compound, I got to understand that since independence, since our president left, our first president left Chilenje, we had this cluster of homes in Chilenje which were in the dark, and so was Matero, Twapia. And I began to think, what am I as Minister of Energy? I'm a woman. And I think you know, 92, 93, there was a serious cholera outbreak in Ruansha. And I thought I could contribute by providing energy to homes so that my colleagues in Minister of Health, when they are telling my sisters to boil water, there's energy there. And when I was Minister of Agriculture, I also realized that most of our women are involved in tilling the land. And all they're looking for is someone to arrive with some seed, some technical support, and they can deliver. And that, up to today, is not available.
So do you look back then and probably say you could have done more?
Well, I mean, hindsight offers you the cave to learn of what can be done better. At the time, Mr. Zulu, you remember that the country was virtually bankrupt. As a government at that time, we concentrated on restructuring our economy, getting our debt written off, which we succeeded. So that experience, when you say, could you have done better? I was not in the driving seat, but what we did as a collective was sufficient to position the country in a way that we could take off. And we began to take off. I think if you go back to President Mwanawasa, President Lupia Banda, we had begun to take off. You may recall that at one time they mistakenly even gave us the label of middle income to move us from
Was that mistakenly? Because the fundamental calculations.
Where is it? The, they took the gross GDP of the country, which included the money that Lumwana and these others had in their bank accounts, and says Zambia is now in the middle income. What is growth when your people are drinking debt water? What is growth when that child cannot sit in a classroom? What is growth when you go to a hospital and you cannot get your bones mended? What is growth when you go to the bus stop and you can't get on that bus? Growth is something which is real, not in a general sense, but in a home. When a family is well provided, then you have growth. And that's why for us as the FDD, we say that we need to create wealth through decentralization. And if you ask me about hindsight, I'll tell you, we now understand as FDD that we are poor and where we are because our government is only found in Lusaka. The over-centralization of government has its own vices. One, corruption. Two, misallocation of resources to sectors which do not impact directly on people. I'll talk about roads because that's usually a topical issue on our programs. When you observe a tar road which has been constructed, say, let's take the latest one is Nakonde Mbara Road. Just go and stand by the roadside. Observe the lifestyle of the people who are by the roadside. They live in small huts. They collect water 20, 25 kilometers away from the tarmac. None of them will ever take a mattress and sleep on that road. None of them will go by the roadside and say, thank you very much. Now we have a tarmac. A bus is coming. I'm going to get on the bus for free.
Isn't that simplistic? Because a road ideally is supposed to bring economic development to an area, and that is supposed to benefit the person who is near the road.
You are right. And you say it's simplistic. It's simplistic from the person who thinks that a road in its nature is equal to development. That it should never be like that. Development should translate to the well-being of those people. They must have enough assets in their homes. I've just said that just by the tarmac, someone, instead of having a well by the tarmac, they have to walk 20 kilometers to fetch water and say from a dirty water pool. Development is something which must be done like a matrix. And when I was at school, they used to tell us something about input-output matrix, that if I put two kwacha in tourism, I must be able to figure out how much of that investment in tourism will translate to good health and it will translate to education. That is what is called development. Skyscrapers alone do not mean anything, in my view, unless people can create wealth in their households. And that's why, as FDD, we say that since 75% of our people are extremely poor, and these extremely poor relatives are in the rural areas, when we are given the opportunity to govern, and that's why I'm running in this election, we will start with a program of free inputs for 3 years to get people to create assets and wealth in their households and then concentrate on the other issues that relate to overall national development.
Free inputs for 3 years. Where will the money come from?
Well, where is the money coming from doing roads? Where is the money coming from for buying choppers for the police, which
so
have you, never
you,
flown?
You will suspend roads and take to account.
That's what you're saying. Right. I think that what I am saying is that development should be seen in an interdependent way, that you cannot pick one sector, say energy, and say, because I'm building a hydropower station, therefore the people in the hospital must not have beds and medicine. Development should be about, how about that grandmother in Chifumwangala's area? What have they received this year? And it's for that reason that as FDD, when I'm president, I want to have a budget which provides for each and every district, so that in each district work is going on concurrently, whether it's agriculture, deep tanks or feeder roads, besides the central government building trunk roads. We can get investors to build the road and put toll gates, which now we have. But why would you take money from the poor children in a classroom go and build a road going to Chingola and Solwezi. When you have a huge mine in Northwestern province, you'd actually take the miners, call them to the table, and the people who can construct railway lines and say, listen, we can provide you a grantee. That's the minimum we can provide. Can you put a rail line and can you put a tar road here? And I can assure you, in the world today, there are investment funds which are crying to look for governments which want the private sector to invest in public roads.
The job of government
is to build feeder roads, to provide support to the families. And when you say, where is the money going to come from? Where is the money coming from now for doing dual carriageways?
You did speak about roads. Is that part of your manifesto that government under your leadership, if assuming you assumed office, will not build trunk roads, but the private sector will do that?
The private, let me tell you that something. I wish you could read our manifesto. In our manifesto, we had put interlinkage of districts, and the PF was very clever. They took our decentralization policy. I'm glad that devolution is now included in the form that you now have executive mayors. If you read our manifesto, you find that we had provided...
PF was formed at the same time as FDD, almost.
Yes, but...
So would you accuse PF of picking your
they've
manifesto?
They've lifted. You should
or they would accuse you of lifting from their manifesto?
No. I think that FDD has the best manifesto. Very clear. And we are the only ones who talk about district budgeting. We talk about district government, including planning up to a ward level. And we were pushing in the technical committees that we have devolution. What has been picked out of that is the executive mayors and executive chairpersons. That provides a platform for decentralization of budgeting. And it's only FDD, because we are the originator of the idea, who can actually implement devolution the way we understand it, that it is not just a political statement that you build Nkema and leave them out there. No, you must be able to provide a budget. Look at Lusaka. When we have an executive mayor, what are the systems that we put in place to budget so that the executive mayoral office is functional? It's only FDD who have the idea that we need to budget for each and every district. No other political party has that.
The amended constitution has provided quite a larger latitude towards pushing the decentralization process. Are you happy with that?
Well, I have said we've made a step. But the next step that we need to make is to have a minister of finance who walks into parliament and says, I'm a bearer of a message from the president recommending favorable consideration of a budget for Nkema district, and I want 20 billion to go to Nkema. That's when we can say we have decentralized. Development comes about when you provide the necessary impetus to growth. And our model is a decentralization coupled with decentralized economic budgeting, coupled with lifting our people from the current abject poverty, where you provide 3-year free inputs, not just for subsistence. Because right now, when you go to the villages, I was in Gwembe, you don't see the usual big granaries of storehouses where they are storing maize. But you see, you watch the fireplace, you see the fire hasn't been lit for weeks because they have no food. We believe as FDD that a 3-year agricultural grant to the farmers, which I'm calling free inputs, will be what is sufficient for us to lift our people out of poverty.
How many farmers are we looking at?
Well, as a party last year, we supported 16,000 farmers. And I'm proud to say that the soybeans in the field, our farmers in Gwembe came and said, we now have maize in our granaries. And what did it take? It took just FDD buying seed and giving to the farmers. We have a lot of sunflower and soybeans in the field. And we believe a program like that, undertaken by a government that cares for the people, would change the face of poverty. If we could do 16,000 farmers in the opposition, what more when I'm president? I have the interest of the farmers at heart. And 75% of our people, which is almost like 8 to 9 million of our people, live on the land. We cannot continue to think that the only people who matter are those in the urban areas. Even the urban areas, you need to go to George Compound.
Are you targeting 9 million people for free grant for 3 years?
I think that what I'm saying is that we have to work very hard. That is the number of people who are extremely poor. If I go to a household and fund a household to grow 2 hectares of maize, let's just take maize for an example, but I would rather we do 1 hectare of maize and 1 hectare of a cash crop, as in the example which we have shown as FDD. The farmers were doing sunflower and soya. Some were doing sunflower and maize. When you fund a farmer 8 bags of maize or 8 bags of fertilizer and give them 25 kilograms of seed, they grow the crop. Mr. Zulu, they will be able to harvest 160 bags from 1 hectare, as opposed to the current FISIP, which is 4 or 5 bags per 4 or 5 acres. It's better a family household concentrates on tilling 2 hectares, and each hectare is properly funded. The first year they will get 160 bags. They only need 10 for a household of 10 to consume in a year. The rest of 150 bags they will sell. Besides, they have either cotton or sunflower or something else. And that way, you are moving people from a position of hopelessness to a position of getting self-esteem. In the second year, you follow up the program. The third year, I will assure you that when you go back to that village, someone will have a canter, someone will have a tractor, someone would have organized the community. You can even go as far as saying, now we have a school nearby here. You parents who were handed free inputs, can you contribute a bit to education? Most of the people are meeting the rural areas, they say they'll be able to come along and do it. The target, yes, is 9 million. But look at what Brazil did. They knew that almost 20 million of their people were extremely poor. And they had a target that every year they should get about 500,000 people from extreme poverty to middle income. And they defined that to be in middle income, you have to have a house, a car, and a certain level of salary, say $5,000 per annum. That's middle income. But when you are said middle income and you can't even afford a meal a day, then we are in trouble.
One of the key issues that I pick out on agriculture is that you have stated that when you get into government, you set up agriculture and rural banks, provide finance, and target the special needs of small-scale farmers. What are we looking at? Lima Bank reincarnated?
Well, I don't know why you go back to that scenario. We have said as a party that in government we have to take care of agriculture. And the mode of doing that is decentralization. I believe that if the people of Chikankata are given 10 million kwacha this year to spend, maybe their first need will be to do the bridges. And the second need will be, oh well, what do we need? We need to do agriculture. As they begin to interact amongst themselves, even the spirit of cooperation will come in. They themselves will begin to form cooperatives. And we have given them the money. They know they have the money. They will begin a scheme there to start lending each other. When government comes in and says, we are putting a bank, you are tapping in the potential in the districts, because each district is separate. It's not just about agriculture. We have, you are sitting one evening, you turn on ZNBC, 2,000 people have lost jobs in the mines. 2,000 households, Mr. Zulu, have lost any sense of being and livelihood. Don't talk to me about the number of children who have not been able to go to school because the mines are closed. And what is the future of those children? And what is government doing? You see, China was built on a cottage industry. What they did for China, if you go to George Compound right now, you find a lot of young people, they are welding windows, they are making door frames, they are making gates, making tanks. But government sits back and doesn't do anything. In China, what they did, they built long factories where these young people are brought in a place and built communal display places where everyone displays their wear. When you see your friends' wear being bought and others are not being bought, you begin to improve. We need to tap into the cottage industry, which our people are already engaged in. They are a lot of things that we can do as a country. Our vision is a poverty-free Zambia. And if we can tap the potential of our people to tap into our vision, then we begin to see that each one of us, wherever we are doing something. Some are farmers, some are welders, some are grave diggers, and some are coffin makers. And how are we supporting our people so that their creative potential goes up? And that's where the concept of banking, communal facilities, so that we can have a big factory with communal welding benches and facilities for young people are involved in woodwork. That also poses as a training facilities. Communal gemstone cutting centers who provide an alternative to us exporting rough emeralds. We go to the mining areas, we can give them communal earth moving equipment. And as a cooperative, they can look after that. If you look at the figures, 5 million of our people don't have access to good water and sanitation. And by the way, water is a right, and sanitation is dignity. And just go to one of our compounds, Mrs. Observe there, just stand, don't say anything. Observe what is happening there. Our mothers wake up very early looking for water. Where there's a watering source, it's a well near a pit latrine. That is, should never be like that. It should never be like that, because sure, we can renew our cities. Even China was a slum at one time. Even England was a slum at one time. But you have to have creative minds who must know that when a town is as congested as we are in Lusaka, there's also open space. You can build up 200 homes, go to Mrs., persuade our people, not force them, persuade our people to look at the option of living in a house with a waterborne toilet, good sanitation and air. And I think it is possible. What is development? Development is not abstract. Development is something you can feel. When you arrive in Abidjan now, you can see that the farmers are happy because President Alassane Ouattara has decided deliberately that he's going to invest in the farmers. When you go to Kigali and you see what they are doing, President Kagame is giving a cow per family for milk and the ox drawn power. What are we doing to our people? We have been giving as a party some improved billy goats. Because when I go in the villages, I look at the goats, they began to look like chickens because of continuous inbreeding. The government is not there. We introduced a bird called the astrolabe, which lays eggs a day. I'm glad that now the ladies who access this particular bird, they are now incubating the eggs. So I can for sure say, as a political party, we have given these chickens. I can now say to these families, can you give my child an egg per day? And it will be fulfilled. That is development. At least I'm providing something. You shouldn't say, no, because I've provided you a school, that's the development. No, that's not the development, because not every child has access to that school. It's only when you say education is a right and government must be compelled to provide that education, that every child, regardless of the circumstances of the parents, have access to education, that you can say that you're developing.
Let me look at your economic projection. You're talking about trying to move GDP growth to 8%. That's quite a high figure. We've not achieved that as a country in a long, long time. But not even when we were Minister of Finance.
But, you know, we are moving towards that. And I'll tell you how we achieve that. If every farmer in my land could earn just $1,000, which is possible, you move it. We haven't achieved that because of our dependence on copper. And I was just saying that one evening you are sitting, or your husband comes home, and he's looking extremely sad. And as he sits down, he tells you, Mommy, I've lost a job. I'm no longer a miner. And your life is doomed. And the children's lives are doomed. At that point, you cannot record positive growth. We have, as a country, dependent on our copper. Copper is a spoon. Copper is a the school. We used to think copper was like a breast. It's no longer the case. We've gone through several busts and booms, and as a people, we've never found the opportunity to learn. I am providing that opportunity, that it should not be like that. We can do something better. I'm talking about agriculture. I'm talking about energy. And I'm talking about how you decentralize the country to take government to the people. Sure, not everything should be in Lusaka, and Lusaka should not be seen to be the Zambia that we have. The Zambia that we have at the present moment is a Zambia where there is complete disparity between those who have and those who do not have. There are people in Zambia now who are extremely rich, but their wealth does not impact, not even in their villages. I've been to a number of villages of my political colleagues. You wouldn't even find the minimum sanitation that you need to find in the village, or water or anything. It doesn't exist. And therefore, what is the value of that wealth? If even in your village, people don't see the difference between how they lived when you were young or how they live now, I think it's a challenge. Even a simple borehole, I tell some of my sisters, I said, if every one of us in Lusaka could go back to our villages and just build a simple pit latrine and a borehole, we'll have a better country. Development is something that you feel, you touch, you experience, you live in it, you create wealth.
Let's look at your preparedness for the election. How ready are you?
We have been ready. I think that our numbers in 2015 should have jostled some people. And if you recall, whenever we participated in the elections, UPND was the third to us. Unless we were not in that election, UPND came second. And we are so ready that now we are suffering the consequences of being very ready, because just 3 weeks ago, you may have read in the press that UPND are actually involved in serious crimes of assaulting our candidate in Southern Province. I'm really taken aback at the fact that the Electoral Commission of Zambia can sit back and say, we still have to go back to Namwala and get a report from the EC
Conflict Management Committee.
Conflict Management
but
Committee.
And these are the systems you put in place as politicians, but together with the ECZ.
Are you telling me that the ECZ has no access to the Conflict Management Committee? Because in the first instance, when Charity was ambushed and she was almost being stabbed, she reported to the Conflict Management Committee, and the record is there. So ECZ must be interested that when there's a hotspot, they should go there. This matter, the police are handling it, is in court. It would only have been fair for the Electoral Commission to say, we suspend you until we hear from the court. But to allow one candidate to continue campaigning while the other one is in bed is, I think, a travesty of justice. There's a tendency that UPND, because they are in opposition, are now telling everyone that they are not the aggressors. In the case of FDD, our main aggressor is UPND, and it's in Southern Province. Now they have gone there and found out that everyone is saying they don't want them, they want another political party. They are violent. I mean, UPND assaulted our people in Gwembe. We are actually the only party who are making serious inroads in Southern Province. And this violence where someone thinks that that's their territory. Sure, Zambia belongs to all of us. And let the people make a decision as to where they want to go. It's very, very unfortunate. I personally find that no one is coming to the aid of those who are victims, and everybody is quiet.
No one is coming to the aid of the police?
I mean, the police did their job. I think I'm very, very grateful to the commissioner, commanding officer for Southern Province. We called him very late, and he was able to originate the staff to go and search for Charity Kabongomana, who was battered and left to die in the village. The police retrieved the victims around 23 hours. When they finally retrieved our people, the car couldn't even move because they had rammed into it, shattered it. Can you imagine a car is parked and someone is just driving onto the car so that it flips over? But it shows that there's a very serious problem in UPND. I've gone as far as saying that for the peace of our country, all parties that are involved in violence should be sidelined in this election, because truly we want after the elections to have peace
should
and stability.
Campaigns be suspended?
I think they should be suspended in constituencies such as Namwala, not campaigns. We want to vote. I want personally, this has been my request to ECZ, that those candidates who are caught up in this heinous crime should be disqualified and their faces taken off the ballot paper. That's our prayer to ECZ. But unfortunately, our ECZ, as late as yesterday, they were saying that they can't make a decision because the chairman is out, because we are waiting for a court decision. They are scared to make such a straightforward
decision.
Maybe
it's because the case is in court, so they would jeopardize
the investigation and the judicial
process.
No, but when you are caught stealing at Ministry of Education, what do they say? They suspend you from work until your case is resolved. It's a normal course of natural justice. But how about the fact that our candidate is bedridden and the opponent is canvassing? Where is justice there?
So from 2% to 9%, next to 50 plus 1%, 52%?
I didn't get your question.
You got 2% in 2011, about 9% in 2015.
That was good.
You're expecting 52% in 2016?
In fact, 65%, because the whole country doesn't want violence. They're actually saying that wherever these two parties meet, whether it's PF and UPND, they fight. UPND has discovered that we have gone in an area which they traditionally thought was their stronghold. They will not come back with the seats that they had boasted before. They will not come back with the numbers that they had boasted before. They think that they are making inroads in other places, but people basically are scared of violence. I've been to Luapula, I've been to a number of places. People are saying, no, we don't want war. When you talk about our chances in this election, I think we are the only party who have the brightest chances, because people are saying they've understood our policies. We are the only opposition party that has even shown and demonstrated what we can do when we're in government through the supply of inputs and all the agricultural activities that we have undertaken in the opposition. And people are saying, what more if this sister of ours is our president? She will do more. And then we are peaceful. We are the only party for the past so many years who have never even been heard fighting within the party or outside the party. We are simply a party who are carrying the beacon and torch of peace. We are the party that have self-esteem. We are the party that has unity, that transfers and radiates love. Because, as I said at another forum, where there's conflict, you know that Satan in his whole being is residing in that home. And for us, I think we say to ourselves, we are made in the image of God, and you love your neighbor and your friend. And how can we stand up and say we want to lead the country if within our party we are fighting, if within our party we are able to murder and maim each other? People will look at us and say, that family, we can't even entrust them with looking after an orphan. You take an orphan to a home where there's peace.
Ms. Nawakwi, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for your time too, and good evening, viewers.
Well, you've been watching Sunday Interview, and our guest this evening was Ms. Edith Nawakwi, the president for the Forum for Democracy and Development. I'll be back next week at the same time with another candidate.